Yeah, so thank you for staying on. I'm an engineer working at Cray on the Chapel project. The presentation today reports on the work done by the entire team. And it was said earlier this afternoon that programming models are the last but not least in getting us to exascale. And I think the Chapel team is well positioned to make progress there. Okay, so back on programming models. Simple benchmark, take two arrays, combine them element-wise, multiply by scalar, store them in another array. In the simplest case, we can think about it as a single sequential computation. Now that we got parallel computers, we probably want to kind of partition our computation, run several pieces in parallel. If we got distributed memory computer, we want to partition the data and run each piece on its own, node. Since my talk is about Chapel, and Chapel, we have the term locale that refers to a part of the computing system that has its own memory. So I'll say that we have, in this picture, we have four locales, and kind of the red lines throughout the talk will delineate boundaries of memory, of local memory. And we might as well replicate our scalar. And even within each locale, we may want to run in parallel if there are several cores available. So this is all good, very simple. We have been there, we know how to do it. So probably we'll use MPI and it might look something like this. So something that's interesting to notice is that the green pieces here, they are the code that's actually specific to the benchmarks, to this particular computation. And the red code there is something that's specific to MPI, something that I have to learn, or the applied scientist who wants to use MPI, they need to learn in order to use MPI. So if you want to run in parallel on each locale or on each node, we probably want to use OpenMP as well. So we add a little bit of this blue thingies that are specific to OpenMP. And luckily for this simple case, the rest of the code does not need to change. It runs the same with the annotation as it does without. So now, if we have a heterogeneous system, meaning we got some GPUs, we might want to use CUDA, and it will look like this. And we got, you know, quite a bit of purple thingies to learn to use CUDA. So basically, these are several programming models, and they all give us kind of a close to the machine feel. So for internode, distributed memory parallelism, we got MPI. For multi-core, we got OpenMP. For accelerators, we got CUDA, OpenNCC, and so on. In order to squeeze the last bit of performance, these models let us be control freaks because we have, you know, pretty good control over stuff. But control freak once, control freak forever. Even if you're writing something that you just want to, you know, write it and forget about it and don't care about performance a whole lot, you still have to deal with all these little details. Now, in a graphical representation of the same thing, if you are close to the target machine, then things get a little bit tedious to ride. And also, we get locked into the target platform. It's not easy to switch to another one. There are high-level languages where computations can be written easily in a high-level understandable notation, and they will port easily. But in the case where things don't run the way you want them to run, you know, the compiler just wouldn't optimize them the way you would like to optimize, you don't have a way to step in and fix it. You don't have the control. So here is where Chapel's multi-resolution design comes in. So Chapel offers this several levels of kind of features grouped in several levels. At the very bottom, we have locality control. This is the construct that tells the compiler where to run the code or where to allocate the data. Next up, we have the base language. This is the base, kind of the general purpose programming features. And like other popular languages, C, Java, Fortran, we have control structures, loops, if statements. We have data types, integers, floating points, strings, object-oriented, and so on. So after that, we got constructs to handle parallelism. And in Chapel, the unit of parallelism is task. So there are tools to create tasks and synchronize tasks. And on top of that, there is data parallelism. And the stream computation that we saw at the beginning is a good example where you want to use data parallelism. So at the very top, you have domain maps, and I'll talk about them more. But they can be written in data parallelism relies on domain maps. And domain maps themselves can be expressed using data parallelism or any other features in the language. So the philosophy here is that we want to let the programmer separate the algorithms, the algorithmic concerns, from the details of the implementation. And if you think about all the people who are involved in writing software, all the way from applied scientists to parallel programmer who tunes. So applied scientist knows what it is that we are computing. He knows the algorithm. Parallel programmer probably can step in and tune for performance. And also we got the library writers and compiler writers. So out of all these people, they all have different strengths. And we'd like to let each of them spend their energy where their expertise is. So this is what Chapel code looks for stream. And let's see, how are we doing on time? I just want, so what strikes me about this code that it's pretty readable. We declare some parameters here, some variables, do initialization and run the actual computation. So if I tell you that square brackets here denote index set from 1 to m in this case, and a, b, and c are arrays, this, you know, you can probably figure out what's going on. And at the very bottom, this is actually an array-based computation, so it's done element-wise. But, you know, where Chapel really steps in is that you can take this code and run it in a variety of different ways. You can run it as a serial computation. You can parallelize it. You can distribute your arrays, a mix of those, and probably several others. And all you need to do is the special source, which is our domain maps, and they go there, and I'll show them a little later. So to illustrate how our domain maps work or what they do, so think about two aspects of this code. First, the arrays. How do you want to implement those arrays? And second, the computation. What do we want our computation to be like? So for arrays, the very first question is how do we lay them out in memory? Column major, row major, Z order, whatever. You know, if we got sparse arrays, there are even more options for us to play with. And if we got distributed memory, it's even more interesting because we can put the whole thing on one locale, distribute across locales, maybe dynamically rebalance, and so on. And so all these details are specified by domain maps in Chapel. Now for loops, the implementation question is how do we divide the iteration space between the tasks? And also, you know, you might want to use, for example, some dynamic algorithms. And you know, similarly, do you want to run them on one locale, distribute, whatever? And again, domain maps come over here in to the rescue. And I just mentioned here that to implement parallel loops, Chapel uses the concept of leader follow iterators. And I'm not talking about them today, but they are written up pretty nicely in the Pegas 2011 paper. Okay, so if we kind of squint a little bit at the Chapel stream code, So we declare the index space and the arrays and kind of run the computation. Now, here in this code, in the very first version, there is no special source. So the programmer just wanted to express, like at the high level, what's going to happen. In that case, compiler gives some reasonable default behavior. And or technically speaking, it will be a default domain map. And what that's going to do, it's going to put the whole thing on one locale, and it's going to run multi-core if that's available. And you can, there are some parameters that you can tune how many tasks you throw at this. So let's say we have multiple locales, we want to distribute in a block fashion. All you need to do is take that same code and put in a domain map annotation. And in this case, this is the block domain map that comes from the library. So, and once we've done that, we are gonna get our data partitioned in block fashion across our four locales. And when we run the computation, it will run in parallel on each locale, depending on how many cores we got. So, and this domain map annotation is the only thing that you need to change in this code and for this pretty drastic behavior change. And likewise, if instead of the block domain map, you plug in the cyclic domain map, you get your arrays distributed in a cyclic fashion. And computations on each locale will again run in parallel. So that's very good. So in a couple of minutes that I probably don't even have, I'll give you a little more detail about how Chapel actually does that, like at a more technical level. So this array-based computation that we started with is actually an implicit parallel loop. And compiler rewrites it behind the scenes into this kind of construct, where lowercase abc are loop variables, and they iterate in sync over the three arrays. And actually, we use for all loops in they can be easily found in our source code. Now, that for all loop is a parallel loop. And what that means that the compiler modifies it furthermore into this kind of more complicated construct. So what there are a bunch of details here, but what you really want to see is that there is this iterator here that gets invoked. And that's the, let me see. So iterators are like, in Chapel, they're like generators in some other languages. Basically, it's something that can generate several values instead of one. And also, iterators introduce parallelism, and they introduce distribution. So the important thing here is that this iterator comes from the domain map. And the compiler plugs it in for you. So the domain map might look, so the domain map is going to implement that iterator something like this. So the first red line says create one task per locale in this kind of run. The second line says run that task on that locale, ship it over. Third line says create as many tasks as there are cores on your current locale. And the fourth line says, and now compute which part of the iteration space you got and go run, do that part of the iteration space. So you see that the domain map, which is at the very top of our resolution level, uses locality control, uses task control, uses general purpose language features. So it traverses the whole resolution stack of the language. And this is all done strictly in the Chapel code. So to summarize, domain maps serve as recipes for how to implement the data and how to implement computation. So Chapel provides a set of domain maps. We've seen block and cyclic. There are several domain maps that tell you how to lay out arrays on a single locale. And more interestingly, the user can step in and write his or her own domain map, should that be necessary. And the domain map, the full power of Chapel can be used to write a domain map. Writing domain maps is, at the moment, pretty challenging affair, but the fact that you can use Chapel, such a nice language, makes it much more pleasant and enjoyable. Just unbelievably enjoyable, I would say. And so you can use all the resolution levels of Chapel, and that's available to you, but you don't have to do it if you don't need to. You are not forced to use it. So like looking back at the multi-resolution design, basically we try to separate algorithm concerns from the implementation concerns, so that people who participate, who write software, they can focus on their own areas of interest. So I'd like to briefly mention a couple of empirical evaluations of Chapel. Anthony Navarro and others implemented several iteration partitioning strategies, in particular OpenMP, dynamic and guided, like partitioning strategies, and also adaptive strategy based on work stealing. So the data we'll see pretty favorable, but what's really interesting is that this was all done within the Chapel language itself. You know, if you wanted to implement a new iteration strategy in OpenMP, you'd probably have to, you know, bang the door of the OpenMP committee or get some compiler, one of the compiler writers to implement that for you. But here you just, you know, write a little, you know, piece of Chapel code, and then that does it. And also, once that code has been written, we can add it to our standard library, and it actually is available. And an application writer can plug in one strategy instead of another by just using a different iterator with minimal code changes. So let's see. So this is one set of experimental results. It's basically the four benchmarks at the bottom run a bunch of loops. Oh, a bunch of iterations of a loop. Fine benchmarks run a bunch of lots of small loops. Coarse benchmark runs a few large loops. Triangular ranges the loop duration from small to large, and random uses random loops. And we can see that in all four cases. So these are speed ups compared to the C version. So larger is better. And basically the middle bar is Chapel, and the rightmost bar in each group of three is OpenMP, handwritten code. And we can see that basically Chapel is pretty competitive. And also, I'm not showing the data, but for the two irregular benchmarks, triangular and random, actually the guided strategy does better than dynamic. Just like you'd expect. And so this is comparing the adaptive work stealing based strategy against OpenMP guided strategy. And this is for triangle and random benchmarks. And for those, adaptive strategy is certainly better than, is more appropriate for the task than a guided. And we can see here, these are again speed ups, and between two bars, the right bar is Chapel. We can see that, especially as we scale up the number of cores, Chapel goes ahead. Let's see. So another work was done by Albert Sidelnik and David Padua and others at the University of Illinois. They created, let the user target their code to GPUs. And again, that was, they wrote a GPU distributed domain map that can be substituted into your program with minimal changes. They use parboiled benchmark suite and compared Chapel with the GPU domain map against handwritten CUDA code. And so I picked the two more favorable benchmarks of the suite. So for MRI, the two bars on the right, the Chapel, and the left bar is the CUDA code. For MRI, Chapel is pretty much on par, and for two-point angular correlation, Chapel is still pretty close. So also they compared the code size of the Chapel code and the CUDA code, and Chapel code is can be up to two times shorter and perhaps two times more clear as well. Let's see. So I just want to mention that we developed Chapel as an open source project under the BSD license. It's been ported all the way from laptops to Cray supercomputers and also systems from other vendors. Please go ahead, try it, and we like to hear your opinion about the language and like to see what you know, how to improve it. So what's on our horizon is we are working on hierarchical locales, and this is a way to present modern computing, modern heterogeneous computing or multi-level computing systems in more detail. So for example, each locale may have more fine structure inside it. It may have several CPUs, it may have accelerators and whatnot, and we want to be able to present that nicely in a language. We are currently pushing hard on performance optimizations and also looking forward to make it more a community language. So Chapel is una buena idioma, and there is some more information on the online, and I'm going to take questions.